Live from the green space, this is Soundcheck. I'm John Schaefer, and coming up on the show today, in a little while, you will meet the rapper Heems. Himanshu Suri is his given name, but as Heems, he was part of the group Das Racist, which actually performed a couple of years ago right here on this stage, and he is back to perform with Dapwell, also from Das Racist, real name Ashok Kondabolu. We'll be doing a Q&A at the end of the performances today, so have your questions ready. But our first guest is the reason that you've all been enjoying these delicious Taiwanese steamed buns, or bao. Eddie Huang is the chef and proprietor of the East Village restaurant known as Bao House. And if you've ever been there, or if you've ever seen his video series on Vice TV, or if you've read his memoir called Fresh Off the Boat, you know that Eddie is a huge hip-hop fan. But what we've recently learned is that his musical tastes can occasionally go beyond hip-hop. Watch this clip.
Cool. Yeah. Fossil fly! Circle in the dark skies! Fucking carry it from the ground!
You need to add some distortion.
Vultures fly!
That's loud.
Yeah.
But you need distortion. That's
oh, I need a distortion.
Vultures fly!
Okay.
Fossil fly! Circle in the dark skies! Fucking carry it from the ground!
Yeah, that's it!
Yo, so how did I lose my voice so fast?
You use too much throat. You need to use your stomach and, yeah, chest.
Really? Mega pause. Don't use the throat, kids.
Eddie Huang, welcome to Soundcheck. What's up? It's good to be here.
All right, my mic's just turned up.
What the hell was that?
Oh, that?
Yeah.
That was some Taiwanese death
black metal?
Yeah, black metal. But yeah, they really wanted to like break model minority myths too. So, peace to the gods. You know, I'm glad they're doing their thing.
So that was actually you in Taiwan.
Yes.
Which is, of course, where your family is.
Yes.
From.
And the Taiwanese thing about it was that they did that. They had a school to learn how to scream. You know, like they had a school to teach you how to do death metal, which I thought was like a very Asian approach to, you know.
No. There's I mean, we've actually, you know, in the past on Soundcheck, we've had people, you know, who teach you how to do that screamy thing.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, because
learned the Suzuki method combined, like I think they were doing like the Suzuki method and the black metal together.
Yeah, no, but I mean, as you learned, that's a great way to blow out a vocal cord if you don't know what you're doing.
Yeah. Like, I just can't imagine going to school for hip-hop. Like, all right, swag, you know? That would be kind of strange.
Now, your family is originally from Taiwan, and you quote your dad in the book as referring to the U.S. as the land of opportunity, free love, and the Bee Gees.
Yeah, and, you know...
That apple fell far from the tree, didn't it?
Yeah, I mean, the Bee Gees is one of the greatest karaoke groups of all time, I think. Like, them... And Wham. Wham is a great karaoke group, too. So in Taiwan and China, they're very, very popular for that reason. And no, but my dad also got it twisted because the Bee Gees, they're like Australia and British.
And UK, yeah.
Yeah, he just related everything rock and roll America.
So, but your musical taste turned out to be quite different. So what was music like in the home? Was there music in the house?
My mom would play the wackiest, like, Chinese Qigong music. And it was literally, like, listening to birds in, like, desolate parts of China. Like, brr, 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 brr. Like, that's basically what was going on, like, all the time in the house. And I kind of wanted to kill myself. So we didn't even get to watch cartoons in the morning because my dad would karaoke at 8 a.m. Saturday morning. And we never got to watch Ninja Turtles. Like, we'd have to, you know, watch it at somebody else's house or watch it recorded on VHS or something because he always took over the television to karaoke in the morning.
So how did you get into hip-hop?
You know, it's funny. Like, a lot of people ask because obviously, like, I'm Chinese, so I understand why people ask. But for me, I never thought about it. I kind of was just in it. But if I had to explain it, I think it's because in America, you're sometimes given like a false choice between like white and black. And you know, I never saw Asian people on TV besides like, you know, Bruce Lee. I'd see Kung Fu The Legend Continues, but that dude was white.
Yep.
And then I'd watch, like, The Last Dragon, and I was like, I relate to them more than Kwai Chang Kang. And so, you know, it just went hip-hop, and it was funny. You know, I always imitated Michael when I was a kid, and I think for a lot of people, like...
Michael Jackson,
yeah. And, you know, I think a lot of 80s babies, you imitate Michael, and then it's, like, a movement towards hip-hop. But I tell people the story, because I lived in D.C., and we'd see Elm Street, and it was Nightmare on Elm Street, you know, and we were like, yo, that's our street, you know? And then DJ Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince mm-hmm. had Nightmare on My Street, and that was the first cassette tape I ever bought. I begged my mom, I was like, yo, you gotta take me to Sam Goody or like The Wiz, you know, like we gotta cop that tape, and I copped it, and that was the first like tape I ever bought in my life. Mm-hmm. And it was just on from there, you know? I definitely remember when I was a kid and in elementary school, I was really picked on all the time. People always made fun of me, but I had jokes and I would snap on people. So when I heard The Chronic and all they did was just
snap. By Dr. Dre.
Yeah, they would just snap on Easy the whole time. I was like, yo, I really get down with these dudes. So yeah, that's what it is. I think you're presented with a false choice and you know, I didn't really relate to a lot of dominant culture mm-hmm. and hip hop was my thing. Like it was the one thing that I saw in The Matrix that I could get down with.
Well, now you talk in the book. I mean, the language in the book is like this funny kind of patois of English, a little smidgen of Chinese, but lots of hip hop lyrics, lots of basketball lingo, yeah. You know, basketball references. And you talk about being in Orlando and being like at one point really aware that Orlando kept drafting white guys
yeah.
in the NBA draft.
Yeah.
So even as a kid, you were seeing
yeah.
that kind of choosing of sides,
yeah.
so to speak.
Because I was like, it's very clear who we should be taking. Do you know, it's very clear, like, we should draft Paul Pierce, but you went and got Michael Doliak. You know, like, it's very obvious who you should be drafting. I don't know. Like, I think actually Doliak got drafted after Pierce. But, I mean, the thing is in multiple drafts, I would see them, like, you took J.J. Redick. You know, they took Michael Doliak. They took Matt Harpring. You know, like, there was always, like, the Orlando Magic draft approach was, like, the same Utah Jazz draft approach, like, draft the best available white dude. And I always felt that that's what they did. Which is why I really liked the Knicks. The Knicks was always, like, just draft the most ratchet dude. Mm-hmm. Except when Ron Artest, they went Frederick Weiss was, like, the worst thing ever. So, yeah.
We're speaking with Eddie Huang, the chef and proprietor of Bauhaus in the East Village and author of the new memoir called Fresh Off the Boat. There's a term, you use it at one point here in the book, and in fact there's a Chinese pipa player here in New York named Min Xiao Fen. She's written a piece called ABC, American-born Chinese.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean? Other than the obvious thing of being Chinese-born, I mean, there's a further meaning to it, right?
I thought it was just meant that I'm Chinese and I was born here.
Okay. I got the impression that maybe it went to the... You started off by using the term model minority, and I got the impression that it was sort of tied in with that.
Oh, no, I think ABC is a colloquial term that, you know, Chinese parents will call their children. It's actually a term, we don't own it. It's like, I don't like claiming ABC. That's what I am, you know? But like, your parents will be like, oh, he's an ABC. Do you know what I mean? Like, yeah. When you hold your chopsticks in a funny way, like, that's when you'll hear ABC come out, you know?
So,
or you don't hit, like, the right scales on the piano, like, oh, ABC.
So what is the model minority thing? What does that mean?
I mean, I think it's pretty much, like, you already know what time it is. It's, like, the people who are really just happy to be under the bamboo ceiling and really, like, they live that cubicle life, I think. And no offense to anybody who lives a cubicle life, but... You know, I think that's like the modern Great Wall. For real, you know? I think I wrote that in the book.
You wrote a lot of stuff in the book.
Yeah.
A little of which, I'd love it if you could read for us.
Cool.
This is a passage from Eddie Huang's Fresh Off the Boat.
Thank you.
It's right there. Do you need to set this up for us?
Oh, this is, well, you know, this is a passage from high school. My boy Warren lived across the street, was my best friend, and we kind of became friends over Wu-Tang. And the first thing he ever asked me, it was funny because I don't know if he had met a Chinese person before, and I was dressed the way I was dressed, like big basketball shorts and whatever. And I used to have like a half moon in my head or like racing stripes on the side. And he just looked at me once and he's like, "Do you listen to Wu-Tang?" And I was like, "Yeah, man. Like, but thank you for stereotyping me, B. Like, thanks for calling me out on that." And we listened to hip-hop together, but then he started dating this white chick down the street that drove this, like, red Toyota Celica. And then he started listening to, like, Modest Mouse and Incubus. And I wrote here, I said, "Dude went from Wu-Tang and Menace to Society soundtrack to Modest Mouse and Incubus. I wanted to puke in my mouth every morning listening to that. I started bringing my Discman in the whip just so I could avoid listening to songs about water and wine or whatever it was Incubus kept going on about. In the end, some people can only keep up the hip-hop thing so long. I think hip-hop is real for a lot of white and Asian kids, but there's a point of diminishing returns. That's when they make an upward assimilation. I didn't listen to hip-hop for strategic reasons. I loved it. I needed it. Watching my white and Asian friends move away from hip-hop opened my eyes to this rite of passage that I was never going to join, the ascendance into whiteness."
So you're a hip-hop fan for life. You're a lifer.
Yeah, yeah. And I'll tell you honestly, I don't consciously think about it. I've only consciously thought about it when, like, people ask me. Mm-hmm. But no lie, like, I've never had any black people, Puerto Rican people, Dominican people, Chinese people ever ask me about it. It's really, like, I think people from dominant culture, like, think it's kind of strange. And I always answer the question because I get it. You know, you get it. You see certain people do certain things. It's different. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? Like, when I see a white dude speak Chinese, it's different. I ask him about it, too. So it goes both ways, you know. But I never, like, you know, when I'm in the hood or whatever, no one ever asked me. Like, I run up in the taff houses back in the day, nobody ever asked me, you know.
Well, we were listening to some of your Spotify playlist here in the green space before going on the air.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, it's not just the hits. I mean, you're clearly, you know, still kind of crate diving, you know, digging for the newer emerging artists and stuff.
No, always.
And so is that what plays in the restaurant?
Yeah, in the restaurant we play a lot of goofy stuff. You know, like I'll play Young Jake Datamosh. You know, I told you about Young Jake, and then, you know, we play a lot of different music. We play a lot of people's mixtapes, not even the, like, album music. People will drop off their own mixtapes or their mixes. So we always try to keep it bubbling. You know, I honestly tell people, like, don't play Doggy Style. Don't play The Chronic. Don't play, like, you know, Young MC Bust a Move. Like, you already know, like, those, like, corny frat, like, college party, house party music jams. Like, I really don't play any of that, like, MTV Party to Go stuff. So, yeah.
So, were you, I mean, you know Heems, right?
Yeah. I met Heems at Bonnaroo. Yeah, we were like in the artist tent, just doing what we do in the artist tent.
What do you do in the artist tent, Eddie?
We were just smoking weed, looking at his panda shoes. He had these Jeremy Scott panda shoes on, and he's like, "Look, watch, I'm gonna put them back in the wilderness, B." And he threw them into the grass, and it's just like, I mean, I was blazed, so I thought it was really entertaining. So, yeah, set them free, Heems. Let the pandas go. So, I mean, that's kind of what happens.
Eddie Huang is with us.
Very, you know, highbrow
live
activity.
Live in the green space on Soundcheck. And that's the kind of storytelling that you get in spades in his new memoir called Fresh Off the Boat. It is a very entertaining read, and we'll talk more with Eddie in a moment. But having mentioned Heems, we should hear some music.
Yes, definitely.
And he'll be joined by Dapwell behind the, I was going to say turntable, the digital version of a turntable. Please welcome to the stage here at the Green Space, Heems and Dapwell.
Free Hema, free Hema.
Hello. I'm gonna do some rapping for you in this very sterile environment. I did this 2 years ago. It's just as weird as it is right now. This is a song I made about eating lots of food. This is the first rap song I made ever, probably in
2005. 2005,
huh?
At the CCNY recording studios.
It was 2003. It was right after high school.
Nah, I wasn't.
Yeah.
Nah.
2005?
Yeah.
All right.
I remember because I didn't go to college, so I remember anytime anyone came back to New York, I'd be like, hey man, I'm still here. Here's the song.
Yeah. Heems. This is the can you turn the beat up? I ain't got love handles, got thug handles. My life a game of dice and me, I gamble. On the major deacon, I'm a major freakin'. Ballin' out with burgers like eight every weekend. But not just burgers, got some cheese on that bitch. Storing every slot, cause I got disease in that bitch. Doctor said hit my shoe, watch your cholesterol. I said, doctor, please, man, please, just let me fall. I'm just kicking it, crown fried chicken it. Finger looking good, so my fingers, I be licking it. KFC for Kennedy. Unhealthily, but let it be. My junk food game is of another pedigree. You a guy, bro. Me, I'm a guy, bro. Anything tastes better with adobo or sazo. Mountain Dew extreme, so I do me. Tune out with latest Skittles and that juice that's fruity. I don't wanna wait. That was an American rap song for you.
That's Heems, and with him, Dapwell, both formerly or maybe potentially even still with Des Racist. What's going on, Heems, with the band? Is it broken up or no?
Sure, whatever you want.
If you're giving me the choice, no, you're not broken up.
Okay, whatever you say, man.
Heems and Eddie Huang with us live in the green space on Soundcheck. Would you like a bow?
Yeah, sure. It's great. I'm going to eat it later, probably.
Well, I'm going to take one now because I'm hungry. So, did you get one of your own bow, Eddie?
Oh, no. I had a smoothie before I came.
What kind of smoothie?
For folks who haven't been to Bauhaus, what is a bow?
It's a bow, and we serve
guo bao,
yeah. Bao is just a word for like steamed bread in Chinese, and then you could get them in like manto form. You could get them in all different shapes and sizes. We serve guo bao, and then it's like in the shape of a taco. Mm. And the meat's usually better if you eat it in the bread.
Yep.
But you are on some futuristic stuff right now.
Mine is really falling apart big time here.
You're really eating it like an astronaut.
I've got like a zero gravity thing. I'm a mess all of a sudden.
Yeah.
This is great. What is this? Some kind of like really thick bacony thing.
Yeah, pork belly. Yeah, slices of pork belly.
Wow.
You enjoyed your tofu, sir?
Yeah, I like it. Yeah. I don't normally like tofu, but it's good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I like it. Yeah, it's good.
Well, I just figured, you know, since we have them and since Heems just rapped about food.
Yeah.
Not for the first time.
Nope.
That it seemed appropriate. So you guys, you know, you've bonded over a love of food and other...
Well, mainly pandas.
Sneakers,
pandas,
sneakers.
Pandas.
I do remember that, and thanks for reminding me of that.
I still got
fun.
The Instagram. I got the IG.
I was throwing my sneakers as far as I could, and then I was look at them in the grass, because it was a panda, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You even felt bad about taking the sneakers back. You're like, they're so happy in their natural
habitat.
I didn't
want to put them back on. I wanted to leave them.
Yeah.
But now you guys also share a love of hip-hop, and Heems, you're a first-generation American as well, right?
Yes.
Where are your folks from?
India.
Mm-hmm. And they settled here in New York, or did you?
Yes.
So was your experience akin to Eddie's, sort of growing up, the kind of the...
Well, he didn't have to do a bid in Orlando. I did the 10-year bid in Orlando.
I was in Queens the whole time, surrounded by Indian people.
In his wilderness.
I grew up about... I was my dad's brother on 250th Street, and then me on 251st, and then my dad's cousin on 252nd Street.
Mm-hmm.
So I just, yeah, everybody lived right around each other in the same neighborhood.
And so how did you get into hip-hop? Because presumably that was not playing in the house at your... At the,
yeah, a little bit.
Really?
Yeah. Well, I have an older sister, but she was more into, like, MTV. I remember my grandfather being like, turn that Madonna off. And she was into, like, SWV and a lot of, like, R&B. So I kind of got into R&B because of her. But Rap was just what was around. There wasn't really any other music. It wasn't really anything I thought of. It wasn't conscious. It was, if you grow up in New York, it's rap and basketball are pretty much inevitable.
So, as was the case with you in Orlando, Eddie, I mean, rap and basketball, it's...
Well, Orlando, like, we only had one hip-hop station. You know, I think New York, it's, you're lucky. New York, you get it. This is the Mecca, you know? And no matter what anybody says, like, this is the home of it. This is where it started. In Orlando, you had one hip-hop station, 102 Jams, and they really didn't even play. Like, we didn't even listen to Nas's album on the radio until It Was Written came out. Like, they didn't even really play Illmatic in the beginning. They kind of just played Poison. But then I remember they wouldn't even play, on the top 40 format, like Z100, they'll play hip-hop.
Right.
That didn't happen until Eminem came out. Like, in Orlando, once Eminem came out, he crossed everything over. And you know, I love him. I love what he did. But he enabled a lot of crossover,
right.
You know? And, no, we had to really seek it out. And the one dude in Orlando that had the mixtape game on lock was Tony Touch, right? Tony Touch came from New York and brought mixtapes down. And you had to go to downtown Orlando. You'd have to have somehow get a ride out there and then find them at shops, find them at barbershops. But Tony Touch was the one that put the tapes out.
Yeah.
And then otherwise, it was just DJs, local DJs, printing things on their printers and making cassette tapes. And I would make my own tapes, like, on 102, like, waiting. And I remember, this is, like, totally embarrassing, but the song we all wanted to record on the radio was Mystical, Here I Go. And because we'd all play it in our backpacks. Like, you would put the tape recorder in your backpack and wear the backpack on your chest and blast it. And that was, like, your badge. Do you know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
this
yeah.
is what I'm, this is my set. And we would blast it on the bus and people would shake the school bus. And Mystical song had everybody jumping through the aisle in the bus, so they wouldn't play it on the radio in the bus. So we would blast it, and then the lady would have to stop the bus to tell you to stop playing. But Mystical was like that song that everybody bumped.
Heems, you ever do a little backpack rapping on the school bus out there in Queens?
No.
Eddie,
did Do or Die, Po Pimp, Go Hard in New York? I'm just curious.
No.
Yo, man. See, like, that went so hard down south. So that's what we were listening to. I remember coming, like, up here, and I was like, yo, y'all don't got, like, plastic jewel case for your CDs? Like, because we got all the No Limit CDs in, like, orange and green plastic cases. So, yeah, now, that's what we came
something.
Up on.
Eddie, I mean, you know, you read your memoir, Fresh Off the Boat, and it's like, you weren't sort of, forgive me, built to be an NBA star, but it didn't stop you from playing basketball.
No.
You weren't built to play NFL, but it didn't stop you from playing football. You love hip-hop. Did you ever try rapping yourself?
No, I just never wanted to insult the game like that. You know, I just knew I was not that nice. So we'd be in ciphers, like, you know, when you smoke or you whatever, you would be in ciphers, and I was just like, you know, I should probably just be like the other Filipino cats and either dance or DJ or collect sneakers. So I collected sneakers.
You can't break dance?
No, dude, I'm too fat.
You try?
I'm too fat. I got too much booty to break dance. I tried. I really look like your shoes, like in the wilderness. I look like a panda rolling around. It's not the move. Yeah.
Now, getting back to food, Heems, you were part of that Dosa Hunt film, right?
Yeah.
Which, you know, we did a segment on that a little while ago, had a couple of the guys in. I mean, that's, what did that feel like to be sort of like, you know, scouring the city and sort of going into sort of a part of your culinary heritage?
That was cool. Dosa Hunt's a film I produced and I was in with Dap and who else? It was Alan from Neon Indian and Amrit from Stereo Gum and Vijay Iyer and Anand from Yesayer, and it was Rostam from Vampire Weekend. It was a bunch of basically brown musicians in a van going to eat dosa in different parts of New York. And
dosa is like a
dosa is a South Indian. Yeah, it's kind of like a crepe, but with potatoes inside, right. and Indian spices.
That's crepe. That he
was it crepe?
Crepe. Yes. Crap would be something else.
I said crap, right? My bad. We don't got those in India. That's why I started with dosa. So. Yeah, so that was fun because it was just hanging out like with musicians like we do normally. But yeah, there's a lot of good food in Queens.
Yeah, and I mean, the, you know, we had some of the dosa that you guys brought in, and a lot of them were sort of not traditional. You know, they were very kind of, there was like avocado and all kinds of weird stuff.
Yeah, I mean, even in India, when I was there like 2 years ago, they have like, they have dosa with noodles inside, like Chinese noodles. So they do a lot of stuff with them, yeah.
So do you, I mean, do you worry about authenticity?
No.
What about you, Eddie?
Yeah, no, I think Hema raised a really good point here. Like, I've been, you know, I don't use the word authenticity anymore. It's a recent thing because I realized, like, people were not understanding what I was saying. My thing is more about cultural soft power and who controls the messaging on your culture and the soft power that you have. Because that's the way, like, you know, I stopped reading The Source and I started reading Monocle a little bit ago. And they really emphasize how important soft power is. And so I got hip to it. And
can you explain what soft power is?
Yeah, soft power is the export. Like people, that's the new way that people are fighting. You know, that's how the civilizations clash now, is over soft power. You know, your movies, your music, your cultural exports, and things like that. I think that, like, when I go to Taiwan, it's the same way. You'll see food items like a dosa or a bao, and people are freaking it out. But this is the difference: is that they're freaking it out and doing new things with it, but it's for that palate. It's for that region. When I can't speak for Hema, as myself, as a Taiwanese or Chinese kid, seeing somebody freak out a food item, but when it's like for the West Village, I'm just like, that's, to me, that's not the movement, you know? Because you could cater to them, but everybody's already catering to that palate. You know, that when you cater to dominant culture, you're just basically like sacrificing your things to them. And I feel like there's some things that should be left for the people that came with it.
Well, that's why I'm asking whether, you know, stuff like avocado belong in dosa or Chinese
yeah.
noodles.
It's
whatever.
A good question too. Like, you know, same with music, right? Experimenting with music is fantastic, but when you experiment with music in a way like Diddy did in the late 90s, like that's, and you're just serving it up and you're kind of bastardizing the culture, that's not what I'm about, you know? But I don't try to talk about it as authenticity anymore. I try to talk it with the lens of power. Because mm-hmm. that's how that argument should be understood. And it's not about race as much as like serving the people who brought this and the culture and like what it grew out of.
Yeah. So. Heems, in some of your mixtapes, you've sort of used a lot of sampled sounds of traditional Indian music. Is that kind of getting into the area that Eddie was just talking about? Kind of acknowledging roots and where, you know, what you have to offer as a culture?
I mean, people were already sampling Indian music for rap music. I guess it is kind of so much a matter of authenticity or laying claim to it, but just wanted to kind of do that more and more kind of focused than other people. But, you know, you have like Truth Hurts and Dr. Dre and Eric Sermon sampling Indian music in the 90s. And I guess in a way, you know, Dap has this story where these kids were kind of poking fun at him for listening to rap music, and were like, why don't you listen to Indian music? And then there was this wave of Indian samples in rap music that happened, and it was kind of this moment where we were like, ha, you know, like, you guys like this stuff, you know? And
yeah, didn't Ron Brown use it for Nori too?
Yeah, I mean, yeah. It's just, there's tons of, you know, even, I mean, I was talking to LP about how he might have used the first Indian sample with Company Flow on that record. But then even the Rakim record sampled, it was Arabic, I think. It was something Middle Eastern, not Indian necessarily. But, I mean, it's existed within the culture for a long time, so I can't pretend that I started that.
Yeah, and then there was that whole Asian massive movement in the 90s, you know, where traditional Indian instruments like the tabla turned into electronic dance music and stuff.
Right, that was heavy more in the UK and stuff. And for me as an artist, I mean, I always looked at the UK coming up and was kind of jealous of what they had, because as a South Asian artist or musician, there was much more of a scene over there. I mean, you know, it was because there was a longer history of South Asians there, and politically they had more kind of to speak out against, and, you know, they had kind of a lot more right-wing extremists over there, and, you know, stuff like the Southall riots in the 70s. And
so there's more to push back against.
Yeah, so, I mean, there was a lot more need for art as a means to kind of express, you know, their discontent with the government. Right. And so there wasn't really much of that as a South Asian here, because most of the South Asians that came here between 65 and 75 were masters and PhDs. And So, you know, we didn't really, our ride in America, and it's something I acknowledge as a South Asian, was a pretty easy one, you know? Mm-hmm. And especially making rap music, which is, you know, historically a black art form, I think it's important to mention, like, the experience of South Asians in this country isn't anything near as, you know, as tough as what black people go through with the American government.
Yeah, definitely. And I think that, like, you look at Wu-Tang, right? When Wu-Tang took, like, Chinese kung fu movie samples and sounds like that, that never bothered me at all because that's, you're not serving that up to dominant
that
culture.
That was cool, right? Yeah. Wasn't that cool for you?
It was amazing, you know? Like, it was amazing. And that was, like, one of the first moments in my childhood where I was like, yo, we might could bubble up right now. Like, this might be our moment, you know? Like, I'm going to dust off these cotton kung fu shoes right now. But,
and
no,
then,
that
and
was
And when
huge.
Jin came out?
Yo, Jin, I used to run home from school to watch Jin on 106 and Park. Like, Jin was huge. I emailed Jin when the book dropped to be like, yo, like...
He's out in Hong Kong. Like, he's like a Christian.
Oh,
he's
back,
right?
Here now. He came back. He just came back. Yeah, he came back. But, you know, the thing I would say is, you know, I definitely agree with what he was saying. Like, you have to... This is a black cultural art form, and you never forget it. But I think that people that aren't part of dominant culture... Like, we all share this. Like, I love Jamaican Chinese food. You know, like, I love that. I love Cuban Chinese food. I like Peruvian, you know, Japanese food. Like, I like the sharing of these things. But it's, you know, like, there's dominant culture that has all that power. And I'm not just talking white people. I'm talking whiteness, but also in China. Like, you know, there's that dominant culture that's being fed there in China as well. And in every country, in every city, there is a dominant culture. And it's just, you don't want your things served up to those gods. Last thing on what Hema said, because it's very deep, is that even though, you know, you can't compare anything to the black American experience, like, you can't, but I do think that people have kind of used it in a way, dominant culture has been like, oh, well, you guys have it okay, you're model minorities, but there's still a lot of things that we struggle with, and it's imperfect, the experience is imperfect, and until it's something that isn't imperfect, like, I think we should speak up about it, and I think you do. You know, when you drop Eddie Said Speaks, like, I remember that. That was mad hard when you dropped that.
Referring to the late Palestinian writer,
yeah.
Edward Said. We're speaking with Eddie Huang, the chef and proprietor of Bauhaus in the East Village and author of the new memoir, Fresh Off the Boat, and with the rapper Heems from the group Das Racist, which may or may not be kaput at this point. You did Thug Handles before. You want to do another song for us now?
Sure, I'll do another rap song for you in this.
With Dapwell joining Heems once again on Soundcheck live.
Singing
from the green space.
Dancing and rapping. Doing the raps for the kids in the daytime on a Thursday. Rapping for
computers.
The kids
computer
on stage for the people.
Heems.
Delay, Mr. Potential abortion stat to that cat that pay his mama mortgage, cash is back, wrapped in Nehru jackets, fashion fabrics, front to back. In fact, ayo, it's popping off. In case I go bye-bye from popping off. Gave my mom 30 stacks cash for her safety deposit box. I bought till I'm y'all. With my last few breaths, I will crawl to the mall. You starving, fam? I go Darvin Ham. I'm Marvin Hamlish, yo. I'm the man. I swear my friends are trying to kill me. I'm online watching old interviews and Biggie. My blind is on, my eye on the prize. My grind on the mise. I stay fly to demise. Like a bird in the sky that dies as it glides. I'm mighty healthy now, salad over fries. Even Stop P owns a juice bar. I'm trying to have long paper, 8 cribs, 22 cars. I was buying my paper as a baby. Me sticking up older kids, stealing TI 83s. That's a graphing calculator. Turn the beat up more in these monitors right here.
Gotcha at the party.
Yeah. Blowing on some Marley, cowboy and Arlie, Brown Prince Farley. Tecate at the party to start me promptly. Loud pack, yo, for Godfrey, I got that bomb. We blowing on some Marley, sipping on some Oban, blowing on some Marley, Calvin Gnarly, Brown Chris Farley. My girl look like Jackie O, more classy though. Me, I look like young Placido, Domingo, Tally Ho. I beat it like Ringo, my phone it rings though. That's when I hit him with Dominican Juno. Like baby Juno, my favorite writer's Juno. DS, he my smartest three SAT tests. No depress, he best. Yo, no depress, he best. Till DCS, wait DC's. Never could read, wait could read. At a good speed, but I blow some good weed. It go blowing on some Marley, Calvin and Arnie. Blowing on some Marley, Calvin and Arnie. Blowing on some. What is that?
Ego. It's an American ego, specifically.
Need some more of it. Some more. Do you have any horse? Do you have any horse?
I was a horse right now.
Let's load up some horse. Yeah.
Real rat.
All right. That was the rap song.
Himanshu Suri, a.k.a. Heems, and with him is Ashok Kondabolu.
Ashok
Dapwell behind the keyboard there.
The ones and twos.
The song's called, that's Soup
it's
Boys.
Winamp.
So you can just like...
That was Cowabunga Gnarly. Soup.
That was Cowabunga Gnarly, okay. Yeah. So you can request animals, and Dap will just kind of...
Yes.
So you call for a horse, and we hear a horse whinnying, and...
Mm-hmm.
So...
You want to do it again?
Please don't feel you have to, Dad. I feel like I just walked into a scene out of Blazing Saddles or something.
That's what I go for with my live shows.
Shout-outs to Juno Diaz, Placido Domingo...
Sure.
Just because they scan and they rhyme, or because they mean something to you somehow?
I don't know, man. You know, when you're rapping, you got to say things, right?
You are going to do this song, Soup Boys.
Yeah, I'm going to do that one after this.
The video for that
has
a lot of kind of reference to drone warfare and stuff.
Yeah, the song too, yeah.
Okay, so basically, I guess I was sort of wondering how drone warfare works into the kind of the feeling of the song. At one point, you shout out to Richmond Hill, hanging with people.
Yeah, that song's kind of about, on two levels. I mean, it's about being brown in America, and kind of, I wrote it after there were the Sikh temple shooting, and it kind of speaks to the paranoia of being brown in America post 9/11, and kind of, to a certain extent, kind of using alcohol and drugs to deal with that kind of paranoia. And then I wanted to talk about it on a larger level and tie that, you know, personal feeling to a global level in which drone attacks and being brown in the world is also kind of has its own paranoia that's akin to the American experience.
So in the spirit of thinking globally and acting locally, you bring that back to your home neighborhood of Richmond Hill in Queens, which is where I grew up as well.
Yeah, right.
Yeah,
I remember we spoke about that last time. And you spoke about horses. You like you go to the aqueduct, you watch horse racing sometimes?
I'm surprised you remembered.
I
kind of thought you were walking out of here that night and the next morning you weren't going to remember anything, but I guess I was wrong.
I give off that impression sometimes, but I always know exactly what's going on.
All right. And for the record, not so much Aqueduct, more Belmont and Saratoga.
Belmont, okay, gotcha.
We're live in the green space on Soundcheck with Heems and Dapwell. Here's another song called Soup Boys.
What other animals do you have?
That's it.
Queen's dick. All right. Here's another rap song. It goes like this.
Indian jersey and an ohm on my necklace. Outside Van Buren, I'm parked in a Lexus. I'm waiting for the man, I'm waiting for a gram. I'm waiting for the man to put a gram up in my hand. And I'm looking fresh, you'll never find a flyer steez. Yo, I'm in Richmond Hill, smoking with the Guyanese. Trini's getting higher than a motherfucking fire gear. Punjabi's wild, yo, Himanshu is the Shire, man. They throwing stones at the mosque. I'm in tomb of goons that stoned at the mosque. I'm in the zone throwing stones with my box. You eating stones, I'm seeing drones up top. Like that drone, cool, but I hate that drone. Chocolate chip cookie dough in a sugar cone. Drones in the morning, drones in the night. I'm trying to find a pretty drone to take home tonight. That drone cool, but I hate that drone. Chocolate chip cookie dough in a sugar cone. Drone in the morning, drone in the night. I'm trying to find a pretty drone to take home tonight. Timberlands on, polo rugby on my back. I'm outside, John Bound, I'm parked in the act. I'm waiting for Jay, cause Jay got the day. And when I see Jay, all my problems go away. Now I'm here with my cousins, bars be bumping. Rushing, drinking white Russians with Russians and flushing. Like we could tussle if they look at my cousin's girl. Yo, yo, you couldn't last a day in the southern world. Ruben and Carlos, Corona, Taper. If they talk about us, they got to get shaked up. Wake up, I'm listening to them to say Hindu. But no problem, them not do like Hindu. Yo, I'm stoned at my parents' house. White boys throwing stones at my parents' house. They got busting, hate crime, race war. I'm highest space dog, wildest 3K4s. That drone too, but I hate that drone. Chocolate shit cookie dough in a sugar cone. Drones in the morning, drones in the night. I'm trying to find a pretty zone to take home tonight. I'm rocking Nikes, Time Court, Motorola, in front of Cardozo, in the Toyota Corolla, cup holder, Coca-Cola, backseat stroller, backstreet stroller, hash tree roller, Chole Vatura eater, heater holder, he the chosen heathen, he honing and hold on for ransom, yo, my temple look like the mansion, in the center we be praying, we be dancing, on the boulevard, right on Casina, yeah, we roll the green up, from Mecca to Medina, yeah, they throwing stones at the temple, got me drinking too much, got me going mental, like that drone modest, but that drone flaunt, and all of them drones do what them drones want a wild, and drones want to kill, drones want your home and your dome and your crib, that drone cool, but I hate that drone, chocolate chip cookie dough, in a sugar cone, drones in the morning, drones in the night, I'm trying to find a pretty drone to take home tonight.
Heems.
You do the torpedo sound?
Torpedo? Is that what you hear?
I don't know. What is it? It's like a bomb?
It's a bomb.
What's a torpedo?
Torpedo be like whoosh.
I think it's like a torpedo.
That's Heems and Dapwell with Soup Boys. And live from the green space, you're listening to Soundcheck. We can take some questions from you folks here in the hall. There's a microphone position right here where you can line up and ask questions of either Eddie or Heems or both. Heems, you did a couple of mixtapes last year. What's the plan for this year?
Maybe an album.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty focused right now on my record label. I manage and put out an artist named Leaf who dropped a mixtape on Monday called Fly Zone. You guys should get it. And
Eddie, have you heard Leaf?
No, I haven't. Oh, but I will.
Check it out, Eddie.
I'm going to check it out.
I'll email it to you later today.
I will download that.
Thank you.
I don't know if virtuosity and speed are necessarily your thing, Eddie, but yeah. this guy's got it, Leaf. He is amazing.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, he's awesome. And then in February, an artist named Antoine has a project called In Dark Denim I'm releasing, and then an artist named Lacutus and an artist named Safe who also releases this year. So all right. Just kind of busy with that.
No wonder you look so tired.
Yeah, right?
All right.
Pretty hard on me today, man.
Heems, Eddie Huang, here with me on stage at the Green Space. You're listening to Soundcheck. Let's take some questions.
I have a quick question for Eddie about, you talked about the transition of people transitioning out of hip-hop and you didn't do that. Do you have any thoughts about the transitions within hip-hop and how have you sort of watched this culture grow as you've grown with it?
Yeah, I think it's really interesting because, you know, the one thing I'm not in the camp with is people that are always reminiscing on how good the golden era was, you know? And I thought the golden era was like early 2000s when Dipset was out, you know, like
and Ruckus Records.
Yeah. Sound Bombing too, you know, and you know, people won't say it now, but I'll say it, like when 50 first came out, like everyone was excited, you know, like 50's first mixtapes, and then they had the Black Wall Street mixtapes and all the Dipset mixtapes, Sycamore. But I think hip hop is really interesting. You know, the two periods that I really wasn't the biggest fan of was like the Diddy, you know, the shiny suit period. And then when I thought that streetwear was really popping, people had that thing like, oh, we're going to sign all the hipster rappers. You know, like we want Lupe, we want skinny jean rappers and things like that. And I think it's just funny how when people react too fast and they're looking for the look and the packaging as opposed to like the music and the actual like big movements. So, but I think we're in a great period right now. Like there's a lot of New York MCs popping, like Action is popping, French is popping, so I'm happy, you know, ASAP. So I really think hip hop is in a good space, and it's not something that's gonna go away.
And one more quick thing, you talked about like not being able to see a lot of people that looked like you when you was growing up and seeing the culture. Like you talked about Jen. You have any other people? Like, I'm thinking along lines like Illmind, like as a producer, anybody else you look towards? Like, oh man, it's great that somebody looks like me is really participating and has like a big stage in this culture.
Yeah, Illmind is mad cool, and I was such a head that even in 05, I used to go to Nightingale on 12th Street or whatever, and Illmind would used to do like open mic there, and I go peep that, and I go there, and Illmind is great. He was on Cruel Summer, and he comes to Bauhaus now, so that's real cool. But no, you know, when you saw Jin, when Jeremy Lin was mad cool too, you know, until he bounced, but you know.
You know, I'd like Heems to take a crack at that question.
Thank you.
Too. I mean, you know, looking at it in the rap world, and you know, did you?
I
see
always
people
thought
who...
I looked like a fat T.I.
Who, you or me?
No, I'm kidding. Yeah, I said.
What was the question about?
Sort
rap?
Of about, you know, like seeing people who look like you.
I mean, I don't know. So I get confused with Dominican. So I was just happy to see the Beatnuts and like and Terror Squad and everything. I was pretending to be Latino back then. So so I didn't really need an Indian rapper as long as somebody looked kind of like me was rapping.
So Big Pun was good enough.
Yeah,
for you.
I was happy with Pun came out.
That's fun. I remember white girls with the booties that would pretend they were Puerto Rican. That was a funny.
Can
thing
we please have another question? Give us your name before your question. That actually was, I know, happen to know that was Patrick, our first questioner.
I'm Margaret, and I was wondering if you could talk about the relationship between rap and food. I'm thinking from like Fat Boys all the way to Combination Pizza Hut Taco Bell. Thank you.
Yeah, you could go first. I'll go after you, you know.
I mean, you know, in a certain way, rapping is like, you know, folk music, and you talk about what you do in the mundane, and you have three verses with 16 bars. There's a lot of talking, so... You end up talking about, you know, everything, whether it's something as simple as brushing your teeth or whether it's eating or sleeping or, you know, of course, then like money and sex and things like that. But, I mean, in those three verses of 16 bars, yeah, you end up talking about food. But I don't think it's any different than, you know, the number of things you would talk about in a rap song.
I do think, though, that it is... it's ill, like that you say, hip-hop, a lot of it is about the mundane, about the everyday. It's like... It's Seinfeld music, I guess, right? In a funny way. Because, like, my girl is a jazz singer. She sings jazz. And all her songs are about love. And I was like, you should make a song about farting, right? She's like, what? I'm like, because you always laugh when I fart. I was like, why don't you write about your man's farting? Because you'll write all these songs about your man's ruining your life, your man's, like, taking your heart and ripping it out. I was like, talk about your man's farting. And she's like, you're wild. Like, I'm not writing a song about you farting. I think jazz, there should be some jazz songs about dudes farting.
All right, next All right. question.
Yo, what's up?
What's your name?
Name's Aaron. What up, Eddie? What up, Heems? You're both professional inspirations to me, actually, because I'm a young cook who also raps. I had to put that out there. I guess my question is, like, as someone who just started cooking and is, like, you know, working in Brooklyn, I'm in a space where it's like, you know, it's gentrified territory, and I'm not from here, but, you know, I identify with my community. I've lived there for quite a long time, and I've just been wondering, you know, if you guys have any, I guess, suggestions about how you kind of represent your culture and bring it into that space. You talked about soft power to bring people into your culture but not really sell it out. You know, I'm thinking more on the food side too, because what I try to do is kind of like soul food, but like, you know, in a healthy sense, but like world soul food too. So, I mean, that's just my question, I guess.
Does that mean soul food without lard?
It might be some like free range pig lard. It really depends, but we try to keep it on the olive oil.
No, I like that. I like that. No, you know, the thing for me is it's a great question, and Heem, I'll go first, and then you whatever. But you know, the thing that I was thinking is I didn't mean it like that. You know, no rap beef, but like, you know, what I was saying is like, I wouldn't think about it in a mechanical way. The most important thing, at least to me, with Bauhaus is I didn't think about it in a mechanical way. If you look at apartments and you look at spaces, no matter what you do, if you don't think about it and you just do you, you're idiosyncratic, like as an individual. If you just let it go and you shoot the fair one, your restaurant and everything about it will be you, and it'll be authentic to you, and it'll represent what you're from and all the people you've met. Like, just intuitively and inherently, it'll happen. So I think what happens and when people sell it out is when they think too much about like who they're serving, you know, like just do you, like make your restaurant like your apartment. Like mine looks like a bombshell. It looks like a basement, and we just put up weird things, like cut out people out of Hoop magazine, and it looks like a serial killer's letter, but it's funny, you know? So yeah, that's what I would say. But
I don't know, when you're an artist, I mean, you have to get used to the fact that you're making something you know, about yourself or for yourself, but you're releasing it, and then it becomes for people and for them to comment on and for them to critique. And so, you know, when I'm creating music or art, I've already dealt with putting all of myself into it and having people take it. So in terms of how much of your culture do you let people into, I don't think too much about it, but my culture is obviously a huge part of me, and I'm putting myself into the work. So that's how I think about it.
So kind of the same, I mean, in essence, the same thing that Eddie was saying, you don't overthink it.
Yeah,
it's just,
no.
You know, it's whatever
it's
is there.
It's who I am, and my thing isn't so much how do I, you know, prevent people from, you know, from the culture, but more myself as a person, yeah.
All right, another question.
Hi guys, my name is Michael Raven, and I have a question for both you cats. First to Heems, yo, those hairy frog beats, they're wavy as hell, man. I like them. Thanks. But we grew up in that sort of that Giuliani era, that 9/11 era, where there was a culture of violence and xenophobia. For these new colored kids who have nice things and are like on the internet and tweeting and stuff, how do we foster that critical consciousness and sort of that understanding that where like that pride from where we're from?
I don't think it's necessarily like, you know, if they don't have to live in a world where they're brought down and paranoid about, you know, race and post 9/11 xenophobia, then good for them. I'd rather not like bother them with that.
And for the chef, yo, thank you. That Marcus Samuelson bit, that's tight, because like that guy doesn't know what he's talking about Uptown and stuff.
Yeah, no, but for real, he's Swedish.
Exactly, like he's light skinned, like
comfortable.
Yeah, man.
Chocolate.
My question for you is actually about the sneaker game. So, yo, like we like Dipset. We like sort of. I'm from that era of just like crispy Uptown high top Air Force Ones. Can we bring that back in the 21st century? Can that, like, I mean, cats these days, these Dominican kids with the foam posits looking at Starbursts. What's with that? Why, like, I'm no offense, man. Like, you're wavy. You're looking good, but can we bring back the Air Force One?
No, yo, I love
this
foams.
This is the part of the show where I guess I need to describe Eddie's foot gear.
This is the data mosh on my foot.
the data mosh
on my foot.
It's
right?
Like vibrant blue with a
this is what your computer
fluorescent
looks like
orange.
When you watch too much Bang Bros, that's what happens. right? But now it's on my feet. But no.
It looks like a paint factory exploded on your feet.
Yeah, but trust me, John. This is popping. Trust me.
All right, go ahead. Answer his question.
I really like these. I mean, I still rock a lot of Uptowns, you know? And I think this year was the 30th anniversary. And but yo, you should really check out the Lunars. The Lunar Air Force One, it feels really good. It's good.
All right, we got
very comfortable.
We have time for just two more questions.
Hi, my name is Chelsea, and my question's for Eddie. Where did your inspiration come from to open your own restaurant, and like when did you start opening it?
Yeah, to be honest, I went through multiple outlets, right? I was a stand-up comic, I was an attorney, I was, you know, doing all kinds of other things. I did streetwear for a minute, and I was just looking for outlets, for ways to speak. But I realized, like, Americans, like, they love combo number 5. Do you know, like, we are known for food. Like, we're expected to be good at food in this country. And I was like, you know what? I can rock. Like, I make very good food. And I was like, if I make food that's delicious and people like what we're doing, then they'll probably listen to what I have to say. And that's why I did it. You know? I love food, but it was really so that we could talk about the things we talked about today.
All right, last question.
Hi, my name is May. Shorty. Can either you or Heems recommend any Asian hip-hop artist? Because I love Asian hip-hop besides Jin, Heems, whatever. Got any Asian hip-hop?
Recommendations?
Recommendations that we should know about.
Big Baby Gandhi. He's...
Now, is that one of yours?
Yeah. He's good, though.
Okay.
I promise. The
kind of sheepish way that you said it made me think I'm probably one of your greedhead artists.
Sure, you should check out this dude, Cool Calm Pete, from a couple of years back. He was really cool.
Yeah, no, Cool Calm's dope. And the thing people don't know, Cool Calm, like, he designed a lot of Supreme.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like, Supreme, and he was cool at Calm Polo for a while, and he busts a lot of
people in NBA 2K. Like, for real, Cool Calm, I heard, busts a lot of people in NBA 2K. So
you heard it.
Yeah.
That's fine. All right. Well, thank you. Thank you for your questions, and thank you all for joining us today. I'd like to thank Eddie Huang, the chef and proprietor of Bauhaus, the East Village restaurant, for feeding us here in the green space today. His new book is called Fresh Off the Boat, and the rapper Heems, along with Dapwell, performing for us here on the green space. Guys, this has been a lot of fun. Thank you both so much. Thank you all. Going damn tough luck, dag with that. Still doing puff puff pass. Pull the truck up fast and I tell him, hey, back in the touched up jag jag. Young won't get in camp cerebellum. An old man just going to tell him. Then I see how you're going to react when I'm gone. My last girl want me back that I'm on. Fine stay, you got the grind. Hey, came back, be with the sign say. Yes, I know you wanna see my demise. Why? Church boy acting like a thief in disguise. Ain't even my size. See the greed in my eyes. Axe happy, I hustle boy to the shy. And that ain't even a lie. Please believe me. Gave Weezy a piece of the pie. You can ask Georgia, Regina. The whole west side, I explore with the beamer now. We strive at home. I ride on chrome. Listen, homeboy, move on. That's your best bet. Why is that? Yeah, I've been pouring